So here we go. It's day one. The machines are all clean. They won't look this clean the rest of the trip. We're hoping that all the modifications that we did to each of our machines pay off. You know, they either improve the handling or the ride, add power, or fix something that was broken, whatever. But unfortunately for both of these machines, they're untested. They went from shop to the trail. We might have been doing little test runs around each other's houses and whatnot to make sure the machine was capable, but the trails weren't open in Wisconsin. It was muddy, and we barely had time to get here, let alone do test runs. So you hope by the end of the week, everybody had a great time. The machines are dirty and ready to, you know, talk about the next trip. That's kind of the goal, and hopefully this year's no different than any other year. So you can see us leaving Twin Hollow here. We're trying to be respectful of the other campers. Most campgrounds have a 5 mile per hour rule or something similar, so you're not kicking up a bunch of dust into people's tents and campers or even campsites. I mean, that's just rude. Plus, there's also the noise. I mean, you don't want to be making a bunch of noise and whatnot. Just try and be respectful. There's plenty of opportunity to be loud and go fast as soon as you get away from the campgrounds. Anyway, we're just headed to Rock House right here. Linda's our navigator. She's getting her bearings straight about where she is and whatnot. I'm doing a radio check with Mark. They're, you know, behind us, as you can see, and the excitement is building. So if you ever stay at Twin Hollow, if you go left here and go through the tunnel, that'll take you down into the town of Gilbert, where you can get fuel, or there's some vehicle washes there to wash off your buggy, obviously some food. If you go right, that'll take you to the Rock House Trail System. I believe we needed to fuel up, and that's what we're doing. So as we head into Gilbert to fuel up, Linda's taken some time to get comfortable with the maps and figure out, you know, where we're going to ride for the day. I'm thinking about Rock House. It's my favorite system in the Hatfield McCoys. It's one of the original three trail systems. It's got over 100 miles of trails. And it's got some green trails, which are the easy ones. That's the majority of most of the trail systems. It's got a fair amount of blues, which are a little bit more challenging, bumpy, you know, tight turns, cliffs, you know, that sort of stuff. The climbs are, you know, pretty good angle. Then you've got black, which they call them, you know, difficult trails or whatnot. Most of the black trails in Hatfield McCoys are pretty passable for average riders like us. You get into the red and black trails, those are the most difficult. We've never gone on any of those. We've seen a couple of them, just not for us. I mean, we're in our 50s, we're older. That's not the type of riding we're looking to do anymore. That's not to say we like to putz on the green trails either. We like to have fun. So the breakdown for difficulty ratings on the trails in Rock House is 31% green, 29% blue, 16% black, 8% red and black, And then the 16% of the trails are single track or dirt bike trails. You'll see, you'll come across dirt bikes on all the trails. They're allowed to ride on all of them. But there are a fair amount of single track trails throughout the Hatfield McCoy system. At any rate, the Rock House is just, it's a lot of fun. I mean, I wouldn't call it like any harder than any of the other systems. It's just kind of what I like. Combination of scenery and everything else is, it's just pretty and challenging and technical, but yet you still get some speed and some fun as well. The system connects to Devil's Ants and Buffalo Mountain. Both of those are to the west of Rock House. You can get to them, those systems, via trail or via Highway 52. There's a lot of I guess different information about UTVs on Highway 52. All I can tell you is I've been out here several times, and I've been on just about every, you know, highway that you can get, you know, come across. You're not going to want to go on interstates, but normal highways and cities, as long as you're not driving like a tool, you've got a trail pass, you're wearing a helmet, I've never been stopped. I'm not going to say if it's legal or not, because I don't really know. But nobody's hassled me, but I drive responsibly and respectfully, and it's not an issue. Getting to the other trail systems, way faster to go via Highway 52 than the trails, but that's not really up to me how we get there. My wife kind of just tells me which way to go, and she does a great job doing it. It's so much more enjoyable for me as a, you know, driver to just have that luxury of her telling me which way, you know, I need to turn. That way I'm just focusing on the trail and not really on a map. Leaving the campground here, you can see the Twin Hollow water truck there on the left. We're going to turn left and head into Gilbert here on US 52. Again, you can get food, fuel up, get some supplies, wash your buggy, do whatever in the town of Gilbert, and very close by. It's uptown is like maybe a half mile up on the right, if that. So as we're cruising through Gilbert, headed to the gas station, I just thought I'd show this footage because, hey, I wanted to know exactly where it was and how to find it. The gas station in Gilbert has 93 octane for those of us running turbos. It is ethanol fuel, but as long as you burn it off in your tank before you come home, it shouldn't be a big deal. Definitely don't want to leave ethanol in one of these machines for an extended period of time. But here we go. Here's the gas station. This was us just getting on the trail system at Rock House, and we came across the Hatfield McCoy Trail System team working on the trail already. They're big old dozer ahead of us, and these guys have to get annoyed with us coming through there. You'd never know, at least I've never experienced any one of them that isn't anything but appreciative of the people who are there using the trail systems. They're great people, but I know if I was in that dozer and I saw me coming, I'd be annoyed. They never show any of that. This guy just finishes what he's doing real quick and finds a way to get that big old beast out of our way so that we can get by him. Kind of a cool little thing to see. But here you go. Watch. So if you ever come across a piece of equipment on the trail or something like that, or fire, you come into, when we're out west, we've come into fire trucks and whatnot, like wildfire fire trucks. Just make eye contact with the driver. Make sure they know you're there. Don't like come right up on them, because you don't know exactly where they're going to turn off, because they know the trails better than you do. But they'll kind of direct you where you need to be. In this case, the guy just kind of looked at me like, just stay where you're at and I'll get out of your way and motion you by. Just don't rush him. You know, that guy's doing you a favor, fixing up the trail, and you know, you got to be appreciative of that. So here we are getting by him. Like I said, it was like a minute, and he's out of the way and Mark's going. And now I'm on a nice, freshly groomed trail. All right, so quick disclosure on the GoPros. We're running 212s, the front and rear camera are GoPro Hero 12s. The camera on the pillar is an 11. And then we were going to run another, like, just handheld camera that was a 9. I did not end up running that too often. I ran power cables from a backpack that had some battery banks in it. When I say battery banks, I mean like huge battery banks. Like, I think I had 2 35 or 40,000 milliamp hour batteries. Should have been enough to power the GoPros all day, which they were. Problem is, the GoPros would overheat and stop recording. Everybody complains about that. I don't know why GoPro can't figure out a way to control that, but they can't. Aftermarket companies come up with a way to keep that camera cool so it keeps recording, or I guess I'll be trying other cameras. I don't know. That was a pretty significant climb if you're not able to tell. I normally will run, I started running telemetry software that I ran my footage through last year, that kind of shows the elevation change, speed, the yaw, and all that stuff. It was super cool, but I think it was information overload, number one. And two, the GoPros decided not to include any GPS data this trip. I'm not sure if that was a GoPro issue because they're hot, if that was a user error with the way I have them set up. I'll check that out when I get time. But these climbs are for real. I mean, you're climbing up some pretty steep mountains. If you like this sort of riding at all, go. You'll love it. For anyone that's curious why we drive slow around corners, look how wide my machine is, and then imagine another one coming straight for you at the same speed. People can get hurt out here pretty quick. So I'm just trying to do my part to, you know, not only lead the group, but look out around, make sure nobody's coming so I can have enough time to radio the car behind me, and so on and so forth. So that's kind of why we're driving a little bit slower, because as you can see in some of the areas, it's pretty much down a ways. It's not, you know, a little drop off. It's the side of a cliff. We'll be right back. So Linda and I had been on Rock House before, as I mentioned. We had come here 2 years ago with Steve and Debbie, and while not a Rock House expert by any means, only being on it one day, we were familiar with it and knew kind of a couple of things we definitely wanted Mark and Cindy to see. One, we wanted to stop for lunch at the trailhead by the City of Man, which was north of Gilbert. We wanted to get our picture taken in front of the Rock House sign, which we did. It was pretty awesome. And I think the girls went in the shop, got us some t-shirts and some stickers and stuff like that, which is always nice. Mark is a social butterfly, so he made friends with everybody in the trailhead there. We met some nice people. Mark's just incredibly social compared to me. I'm kind of a, believe it or not, the quiet one when we're out. I kind of keep to myself. Once you get me opened up, I'm fine. But I am not the social butterfly that Mark is. But at this point on the ride, we're finally starting to get our, you know, our comfort level back, where I'm past my machine operating well. Mark is as well. I talked to him on the radio. Everything's running really well. So we pretty much rebuilt the front end of this machine with S3 A-arms in the front. We put shock therapy, tie rods in, as well as Keller ball joints. Pretty much everything was worn out. My A-arms were actually cracked. The ball joints were just so sloppy. Everything's nice and tight. Everything's working well. I'm not having any issues whatsoever. I was able to get just a little bit more turning radius with the S3 A-arms, which when you drive a four-seater, turning radius is everything. So gaining a little bit, that was pretty awesome. So I've been really happy with the way my machine is running. Everything feels great. Hadn't had an opportunity to really test out if I had any bump steer yet. We had no real high-speed runs with chatter or anything like that to really tell. But I can tell you later on, we do run into that. So stay tuned. So we made it to a little stop here, took a couple of shots of the buggies. We weren't too far from the Rock House trailhead up by Man. That was the next stop. And eat some lunch and make our way up to the waterfall. So here's our pics from that, and we'll get going up to the waterfall. So we made it to the waterfall. That was our goal. We came across this group from Canada. They were taking a group shot when we got there. They were a lot of fun. So after the waterfall, we came across this little lookout, and we just had to stop and take a peek. This is about the time when we were all getting tired, and we're going to start heading back towards camp. So this is where we get into the title of the video. We were having a ton of fun until the end of this clip, and then we weren't. Mark was, you know, riding and driving well all day. We were having a ton of fun. The buggies were running great, and it got warm. It was our first day. We were getting tired, and I think Mark was in the zone. He was just humming along, following me, and we stopped at an intersection up here so Linda could figure out which way we were going to go, as any leader does, and as we had done, you know, 100 times. And he just didn't see us and was going a little too fast. And we came up to the intersection. We stopped. He couldn't. And essentially what we think happened is he went up the embankment, flipped on the passenger side, endoed onto the rear, and came crashing down on the driver's side. And here's the aftermath of that. So Mark and Cindy were not hurt. They were smart enough to keep their arms and hands in the machine. They were just a little, I guess, shocked. We all were. I was pissed off because my rear camera didn't catch any of this. It overheated and shut off. I had no idea. I didn't do any recording, like, specifically with the handheld, because I was kind of worried about them and just getting their machine rolled back over. Plus, I just wasn't thinking about it. I mean, here I'm set up to roll this thing over onto its tires, and none of us saw the huge rock, the ravine. I mean, it was just stop, take a breath, look around, and you'll see it. So fortunately, you know, we kind of looked around, assessed what was going on, and decided that, you know, pulling this thing over with the winch right into that ravine, that's just not smart. There was some traffic coming that Linda heard, so she went up to the top of the hill and kind of was guiding traffic, just telling them to wait while we kind of figured out what we were doing. And it wasn't long, and we reset, and you'll see me move the machine here in a minute. So Linda's at the top of the hill, again, directing traffic. There's a couple machines waiting to get by. Mark and Cindy made the difficult decision to let me drag it down the trail. There was a lot of concern that if we flipped it there, it was just going to go in the ravine and flip over again and do more damage. So we drug it down the hill, and then I moved to flip it over with the winch. This is kind of where I screwed up. I'm not, you know, one of these recovery guys like Rory from Trail Mater or Matt from Matt's Off Road, even though I watch them. Shout out to those guys. My machine should have been back like another 25 feet or so. I mean, when I flipped it, everything went fine. But if Mark wasn't there holding the other end, it could have flipped over again. It's just, you know, we're coming downhill. It is what it is. I learned for next time, give us a little bit of space, and we'll go from there. We waited a little bit, fired the machine up, and moved it out of the way completely, and tried to evaluate what we needed to do to get it back to camp.
Well, maybe Andre can make the residuals on YouTube.
So we just rolled this pristine Pro XP.
I really think right now it only looks like plastic.
I see taillight and some. You got a fender flare over here. I did not record the recovery. Got a little front end plastic. doors pretty much toast. We lost the mirror over there too. Some plastics here. Mark's okay. Cindy's okay. My wife looks amazing throughout the whole thing.
So we're heading back to camp. We got it, everything zip tied together, all the pieces loaded up, and the machine, with the exception of the ride command not working, everything is fine. We just zip tied everything together and decided to make it back to camp. We had a warning light on the dash because the ride command was not working. We later determined that to be a fuse. We replaced the fuse and boom, ride command worked. I personally think the machine, even after getting it all cleaned up, seeing it at the end of the week, I think it looks great. I'm kind of a battle scar guy, so I think it looks, you know, pretty tough. I like it. I'm sure, knowing Cindy, that thing will have new plastics on, new graphics, and look like nothing ever happened. Maybe aluminum doors and a wrap. Who knows? I mean, that's kind of all up to them. Point is, Mark bounced back. I mean, after we got everything fixed that night, fix with zip ties, by the way. So this was Monday afternoon, our first day of riding. It sucks tearing up a machine on day one, but we zip tied her back together and they were ready to ride on Tuesday. Tuesday, day two, happens to be the day where I had a little problem. Now, different kind of problem, but problem nonetheless. As you see me sneak by another machine, that guy was awesome. He gave us just enough room to get by. Anyway, day two brought problems for the Orange Razor. Now, if you haven't figured out, the Orange Razor is not stock. It's running a little bit more power, tuned up pretty good, bigger tires, and that catches up to us a little bit on Tuesday, but we'll get into that the next video. So anyway, we're cruising back into camp here. This is the trail leading into Twin Hollow. Again, tomorrow is another exciting day with a, it was a lot of fun until it wasn't, type of event. Stay tuned for the next episode. If you like the video, please like it. Leave a comment. I'm real good about getting back to comments, but I don't have a lot of viewers and I don't get a lot of comments, so it's not that tough. But anyway, I do appreciate everybody that views, subscribes, you know, whatever. It kind of gives an old guy a kick to keep going and making some content. We're rolling back into our beautiful campsite here. Can't say enough about Twin Hollow. We really, really enjoyed the campsite and the view. Take care. We'll see you next time, guys.